have your sincere yea and amen. Surely somebody had to teach us to pray this way. Because on our own, we would clutter up the whole religious area with pious little niceties about brotherly love and charity and lofty Christian ideals. Nuts to that. Jesus teaches you to pray about sin and guilt and punishment, trespasses, temptations, and the enmity of the evil one. Most of us would be quite upset this Easter day if all God gave us was what we prayed for. A daily ration of dry bread. And who of you would ever begin a prayer this way? Oh, my Father, first of all, and before I ask you anything else, because this is the most important, please keep your name hallowed to me. You wouldn't pray that way. And what if God took you at your word and really used you to make his kingdom come to the far corners of this earth? Thy will be done. We only say that when we grit our teeth and clench our fists and assure that God is glorious. You see, to pray the Lord's Prayer is to pray it against you. The Lord's Prayer is a confession of sins. And now comes the amazing ending. And Jesus says, now after you've prayed this prayer that you do not want to pray, and all of those painful petitions, I want you to burst into song. I want you to exclaim words of praise. I want you to sing till the dawning of the last day, the doxology. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Now, you can't command people to praise somebody. That's like trying to make people be thankful. You can make your children say the words, now say thank you. A man who is sure his wife will not forgive him and rub his nose in it, he won't ask her for forgiveness. And nobody can compel us to sing these praises. Something's got to happen first or you'll never do it. Well, that what happened that permits you to praise God is the very thing we are celebrating this morning. Trouble is, though, the words are too familiar to you. The teeny-boppers have a language that I cannot understand. You can listen to two Navy men talking for that matter, and it's totally unrecognizable by the average civilian. But religious people have a jargon also, packed pious phrases and formulas. And usually we are quite critical about what we say and what we hear. But something comes over us when we recite the Apostles' Creed together, that you can actually yawn through things that ought to turn you upside down. He descended into hell the third day he rose again. Oh, someone else is known. And that's unfortunate. Because people will readily agree to church membership, attendance at divine services, the value of religion in a secular society. Well, atheists will go along with that. Even religious windbags know that you've got to have some code of conduct to live by in this world. And you watch this. Next time the Klan is gathered in the living room of your home, you say something like this, well, it doesn't make much difference what you believe as long as you're sincere. Shucks. We're all going to the same place, we're just taking different roads to get there. And heads will solemnly nod in agreement all around. Now that's about the most asinine piece of ignorance that you could possibly state, but because it's the only religious way of talking, nobody bats an eye. You try it sometimes getting to Milwaukee by taking any road out of La Crosse. Now, you wouldn't be that stupid in daily life, or when it comes to religion, or... Or next time you're ill, go to the medicine cabinet and down anything that's in there. But do it sincerely, see? And then tell me it'll be for your good, if you're sincere. Oh, this sort of thing has infected religion. But here's how you stop all the head nodding. I mean, abruptly. You say something about the courts of that Nazarene. Came alive, strolled out of the grave, and is waiting for you around the bend in the road of your life. That'll cut it. But it always has. We can't really picture that first Easter, someone saying to another someone, do you remember that man we saw the day before yesterday, having a bad time up there on the Via Dolorosa? Now he looked up at us, the two of us sitting here on the balcony. Remember his mother, she lives over there 1200 block Avon. And how she was traipsing along behind him, about a block and a half behind, leaning on the arm of Mrs. Magdalene. Well, he's back! And that just set those people to running in a different direction. Something happened. And what it was that happened on Easter morn, you perhaps noticed. You are not given a detailed newspaper account of it. You are not taken into the tomb and given a blow-by-blow account of how he came forth out of those linen gray clothes. Instead, you're given a sort of television thing, a before and an after. Before, where was the man? Well, they had crept away into a corner like hurt animal. And you do not hear them saying in that room, oh my, I'm certainly thankful we have a memory of the old days, his companionship. You don't hear him saying, oh, isn't it good that John took down in shorthand the Sermon on the Mount? You don't hear any of them uttering any stupidity about, oh my, we still have our Christian ideals to go by. Now, either this Jesus Christ is the greatest liar that ever lived, or he actually is what he said, and you can't fiddle around, you know, with this Christian ideal business. He not only said that there was a bridge between man and God, he said, I am that bridge. I am the door. I am the vine. I am the good shepherd. I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life and the resurrection. Now, you got to get off of this business about being neutral or living on your Christian ideals. It's all the way or nothing. And what was it that happened? Well, the girls, the ladies who loved him, did about what you do when you carry flowers out to the cemetery. You know it won't really do you any good. But it's about all you can do to pay your final respects. They were, in blunt language, going out there to embalm a corpse. The only thing those gals were worried about was who will roll up the stone away from the door. The very last thing they were looking for was that their prayers be answered. And something happened. Something turned them inside out, turned these scared rabbits into men who lay down their life without a whimper. And what was that something? Well, Jesus rose. But how do you know? Well, people, it has never been a matter of evidence. Exhibit A, Exhibit B, can you prove it? You see, all of us is in the same boat, isn't it? All of us have the same evidence to search out. And yet an incredible thing occurs. Some believe and some don't. People, it has always been that way. Pontius Pilate on his dinner hour, you know, could have walked over to the empty tomb, checked out those linen grave clothes lying there, certainly spoken to the soldier sentries. He could have gone over and asked Mrs. Magdalene herself about this, you know. But Pontius Pilate doesn't become a believer. And the reason for this is it depends on where you stand. It depends on how you look at it. An example would be these windows. From the outside, you know, they are quite sooty, drab, and dark. But look what happens when you're inside this church. They light up and become really quite beautiful pictures. Depends on where you stand. Jesus stood in front of Pontius Pilate, and all he saw was some itinerant preacher. No kingdom, no glory, no power, no 12 legions of marching angel armies. So Pontius Pilate curled a sneering lip at him. The Pharisees, too. They didn't see anything in this Galilean prophet to bow down before. And people, that's it. If you do not stand under the forgiving eyes of Jesus, you don't see anything here. You know, in order to have a father, you've got to do some confessing. Oh, my father, I am that prodigal, that lost, that runaway son. I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight and am no more worthy to be called thy son. And Father, I can't take it anymore. I want somebody to hold my hand and lift up my head when I cannot and listen to my every fevered cry, my Father. And that's why the prostitute and the publican saw Jesus. They needed desperately somebody to free their guilty consciences, break the chains of guilt. Pontius Pilate would never have known even what to do, you know, if a bunch of deformed people had come into his living room. Or mentally retarded. Little children. Working men who smell of sweat. And sick people, and you know how their breath is. And people that are upset, frightened, and neurotic, and nervous, and scared. But these people stood under the eyes of Jesus Christ, and they saw him, and they found him. And you know, it all depends on that, who you think you are. Mr. Big Shot, of course, you know, pulls himself up by his own bootstraps. What would he need a father for? He provides daily bread for the family. Haven't you ever heard him tell his wife that? Well, he wouldn't see the Father, you see. I read somewhere, this is not a good comparison, but in South Africa, they brought some natives in from the bush into one of the big cities. And this is a little cruel, I think, but they bet among themselves what would impress those savages the most. They took them on an airplane trip, 37,000 feet. They showed them television. They took them into the merchandise market. And you know what gripped them the most? A water faucet that you could turn a handle, and out of that pipe and out of the wall would come water. You see, you know why? They knew what it was to be thirsty. They knew the toil and the trouble of getting fresh water. They knew what happened to you if you didn't get it. Here, living water. And these people who saw in Jesus their Savior, their life, their hope, and their resurrection. Well, they can sing praises. Now that you must be commanded to do, or you won't do it. When you finish praying, people, to praise God. If you were to look in the last book of the Bible, the very last scene you are giving, at the end of the line, there you would see saints, dressed in white, singing praises. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive riches, and power, and wisdom, and strength,
and glory and honor and blessing unto the Lamb. If you can sing praises in your weak and wobbly little voice, you are already joining in with those who've got it made. And you know, if you know how it's going to end, if you know that your little boat will reach the harbor where the lights are twinkling, you are not so terrified of the storm that tosses your bark at this moment. If you know the end of the story, that you're safe, that you make it home, that the lights in your father's window will light your way. Otherwise, how could Paul and Silas have sung praises at midnight in prison? Because they were in a lyrical mood? Or did one of the hymns happen to be on the top 10? Oh, people, their backs were raw and sore from the whiplash. Their feet were fastened painfully in the stocks. The air in that dungeon was dank and foul. Their number, small as it was being snatched up and broken. Yet they sang praises. And you know why? Because they knew the end. They knew that God could even bring his kingdom into those dark prison walls. They didn't stare, hypnotized at one disaster. Poor Daniel thrown in the lion's den. Elijah, unbelieved, running out into the wilderness. That scene in the cattle shed at Bethlehem, or in the dark on Golgotha, they saw the end. Long after Napoleon and Nebuchadnezzar, long after Nero has thrown the Christians to the animals in the arena, long after all their concentration camps and easygoing American paganism, they knew the end of the story. They could praise him already. Try that next time. You see, the man who knows the end, how the game ends, he doesn't panic. Got a lot of time. He doesn't emotionally, impulsively, under pressure, begin pleading like a pampered child. Because he knows the end. You try this next time you're at your wit's end and you see no way out. Praise him. You see if he can't bring into the kingdom your hospital room or sick bed. You who are weary and heavy laden, see if his power and glory doesn't come even into a lonely apartment or when you're at the end of your rope. The reason for that is your father is at the end of your every blind alley. Your father, to whom is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.